So first name, Bilal Mahmud, B-I-L-A-L-M-A-H-U-D?
M-U-D.
M-U-D.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, I spell that last one again?
M-A-H-M-U-D.
Okay. And, all right, so inshallah, maybe first you want to start by telling us about yourself, inshallah.
Oh, okay.
I can give you specific questions, you can feel free to.
Oh, okay. My name is Bilal Mahmud. I'm born in USA. I accepted Islam back in 1973 as a result of having traveled to Southeast Asia. And while in Southeast Asia studying Pan-African history and finding out that the majority of the slaves that were brought to America were Muslim. So upon my returning from Vietnam, I started to investigate Islam further, and upon that investigation, I accepted Islam.
Thank you, mashallah. And you want to be comfortable talking about your children? Do you have children?
Oh, okay. Yes, yes. I have three girls. The oldest is 39. The second is 31, and the youngest is 27. Six grandchildren, starting from 18 to the youngest is 3 years old.
You want to talk about your work or anything, which you did? Or?
Oh, okay. Presently, I'm retired. I worked in transportation for over 35 years. Approximately 2 years ago, scaled down, and now we've taken on a vocation in journalism, photography more specifically. We have a blog that is Oppressed People Online Word, which deals with information dealing with Africans, African Americans, and the Muslim around the world.
Okay, so when did you, can you maybe have a year also, when did you mm-hmm. first get involved with Al-Fadr Masjid? Can you paint a picture like how this happened?
Oh, okay. Upon accepting Islam in 1973, I was in Washington, D.C. at that time. I lived in Washington for about 3.5 years. Then I moved to Atlanta. And upon moving to Atlanta, we found that there were no mosques in the Atlanta area. We were praying at that time at Georgia Tech using classrooms or using people's houses on different Jumas. So, we felt that it was imperative that the Muslim community of Atlanta have a solid base of operation. So in 1977, we started to the building process for the first masjid in Atlanta to be built from the ground up. 1977-78, funds were raised. And at that time, most of us were either students or we had just come out of the student mode and we were moving into the workforce. So there was not a lot of money available. Many brothers during that time took their tuition monies. Instead of paying their tuition, they would sit out for a semester. And they would give that in sadaqah to help build the masjid. So in 1979, we initially started the breaking the ground and the building of the first Al-Farouq Masjid.
So who were the people who did this?
Oh, okay. There were several people, but the prominent individuals that are still left was a brother by the name of Brother Nuruddin. He was the first chairman of the board. There was Brother Nadir Warsi, Tokyo Warsi, Jabril Zakai, Amanullah Khan, Farouk Al-Taruti, who has passed away, Rahmatullah Alayh, and Dr. Khalid Sadiq came in.
By the way, you didn't miss many. It was very good, mashallah. But mm-hmm. if you ever want to just like re-say a sentence, or
okay,
anything,
okay,
you have complete freedom because we can just cut. And
do oh, okay. Oh, okay.
So just yeah, you just let me know. Here,
oh, okay. Mashallah.
Okay. So can you talk about like the vision at that time when you guys were starting the masjid? I mean, was there a particular vision you had, or was there a place to pray? Like,
You have to remember that this was in 1977, 78, 79, and Islam was not as we know it in Atlanta today. There was no masjid, per se, in Atlanta. The community that we know today as the community of Imam Waqidin Muhammad had just began to make transition, okay? So, when we embarked on our project, it was somewhat of, we want this place that we can call our own in order that we can pray Salatul Jummah and eat. There was no real futuristic plan. Things started to unfold as we got involved. So when we broke ground initially, the main objective was to build the masjid in order to have a place to pray, again, Salatul Jummah and the Eid.
Okay. Now, was the masjid, like the first one, you know, right in the same spot where we were here, was it that white building, or was there something else?
Yes, the first masjid was a much smaller building than we have presently today. It was a white building. It was a two-story building. There was the basement that was primarily used for the sisters. Then the upstairs was used for the men praying area. It was maybe a quarter of the size of, not even a quarter of the size of the present masjid that we have today.
Okay, so can you talk about like what you went through to get that first building, the property? I mean, I heard stories about people giving the tuition and all these things. Can you explain this?
Yes, yes. It was a very, initially, this whole 14th Street corridor was an abandoned area of town. There was a steel mill across the street. Basically, the poor and the destitute lived in this area at that time. So the initial land purchase for the masjid was a relatively inexpensive investment. We purchased the land, and shortly thereafter we did the groundbreaking. And excuse me, I had heard, I don't know exactly the numbers, but the initial project, the building itself, was anywhere from $50,000, $60,000, which was a lot of money during that time to pay to build the facility. Again, like we said, brothers gave their tuition. They would sit out of school for a semester. You had brothers who were collecting money. We didn't even have a bank account. We had a shoebox that we kept the money in. And later on, as we grew and progressed, we went from a shoebox to a bank account. But initially, monies were just collected. Brothers were giving $100, $200. Brothers would sometimes, take their mortgage money and give it in the cause of building this facility.
I heard a story about Aman Khan, I don't know, putting his house for sale, maybe sold it.
Right. We had raised a certain amount of money, and time was running close to the time of breaking ground and starting the project. And our brother Amanullah Khan took a loan on his house in order to get the monies that were needed to complete the project. You know, you start the groundbreaking and you get to a certain point, and if you run out of money, the project stops. So he took a loan on his home and helped to made it possible for the project to move to its logical end.
Now, Mahmud was telling one time that there was some of the land here that there was a non-Muslim living, and they didn't want to sell it to the Muslims, so he had to use his friend to buy this.
Right. As you know, there are two factors that we unfortunately find in our society. One is racism, and the other one is Islamophobia. Islamophobia at that time was not full-blown, but if you were not a WASP living in this area, there was certain resistance that you got to building a mosque or having non-WASP in the area. There was a piece of property where the gymnasium is about to be built, and it was very important in our project. And we had approached the individual who owned it to purchase the property, and it was kind of obvious that he did not want to deal with non-WASP in this particular venture. So one of our brothers had a friend who was able to give him what he wanted. He was willing to sell it to a Caucasian, but not to a non-Caucasian. So basically what was happening was that the Caucasian purchased the property, and upon his purchasing the property, it was his property to do with as he chose. So he turned around and sold the property immediately to the masjid.
Were there any kind of other struggles or stories that happened during this time?
Yes, there was struggle in zoning. You know, any time that you're starting a project, and this was a big project back in 1978-79, first of all, there had never been a mosque built in the city, okay? So here you have a group of Muslim that have come together, and they're talking about building a mosque in Atlanta. So permits, zoning, these things were getting some resistance. And as normal, when you're dealing with people from different ethnic groups, you get different reactions. At that particular time, permits and zoning was basically controlled by African Americans, okay? And the city government, the mayor of that time, was an African American. So to send a South Asian to get a permit, it was almost resistant. It was like basically the same thing with wanting to buy the property from a Caucasian, okay? You get resistance. So we had one brother whose name was Khalil Abdul Rashid, rahmatullahi alayhi. He passed away a couple of years ago. He was working directly in the office of Maynard Jackson, who was the mayor at that time. So he was able to navigate through the maze at City Hall, and he was able to procure a lot of the permits that we would probably not been able to get without him being in that position as a Muslim and as an African American in the community.
Are there any other struggles, you know, or stories you can think of? Causing trouble, or just anyone?
Oh, no, not that I can think of off the top of my head, no.
Okay, so how long did the construction take?
From beginning to end, I'm thinking we were up and running in about 8 to 9 months. because when I went to Hajj the first time in 1980, we had just prayed the first Salat al-Jumma in the masjid. So that was a joyous occasion. You know, we were able to pray the Salat al-Jumma. And after that Salat al-Jumma, I was able to go to Mecca Mukarramah for Hajj. Alhamdulillah.
How many people were there on this, like, very beginning?
The building in and of itself will probably hold maybe 700 or 800 people, you know, without a problem. But we had columns about three rows back because we put the columns there thinking that rows in the masjid would never exceed past the columns, three lines, you know, because we were at that time having Jummas where you may have 5 people, 10 people, okay? It was not even imaginable that we could have a Jummah of the magnitude of what we have now, where you have 2,000 people for Jummah, okay? 10 people was a lot of people. 40 people was, you know, it was almost like Eid. So we said that the first two lines, if they're filled, alhamdulillah, we have the space, we can do this. And so that was our expectation initially.
Who is the imam in the very beginning?
The first imam that we had was a brother from Sudan, rahmatullah alayh. His name was Ibrahim al-Nur. And his assistant was Imam Munir Kashlan, who many of us may know, who's still living here in Atlanta. The two of them were the first two imams of Masjid al-Furuq.
And what about the, like, the board? Is there a structure that we have today? And what was that looking like?
Okay, the structure was basically the same from the onset. You had the Masjid Management Committees that would run the day-to-day running, and then you had the Board of Trustees that were made up of the elder members of the community. So the administration of the Masjid has not changed that much.
Okay, so can you give me, like, the names of who was doing what back then?
Oh, okay. Yeah, back then, Dr. Khaled was not a board member. He was the chairman of the executive committee, which was in charge of the day-to-day running of the masjid. Then you had the Board of Trustees that was primarily myself, Dr. Nadia Warsi, Dr. Taqir Warsi, Amanullah Khan, Jabril Zakai, Farooq Al-Taruti, and that was basically it.
So I heard that you were the emir one time in the masjid, or is that right?
No, I was the assistant emir of the masjid. Then I became the chairman of the board, which is now the emir of the community. Yes.
Okay, how long were you doing that for?
I had the chairman of the board for 1 year. At that time, it was running for 1 year. Serving.
And who are the other emirs that we have?
Brother Nadir has been the emir. Brother Aman has been the emir. Brother Hisham has been the emir. Brother Jibril has been the emir. Those are the only ones that we have left.
So when you have the white, you know, the first masjid, did the vision start changing? You said having more people come ever?
Oh, okay. Basically, the vision was that, again, our initial intent was to build a place wherein we could perform Salat al-Jumma and Eid and have a place for weddings and these type things. As a result of our coming together, we heard that there was a Syrian family in the city, and that they were interested in starting a weekend school. That was the family of Brother Hisham with our sister Nabila Hawasli. The school was started on the weekend. There was a Saturday and a Sunday school. What happens in the community is when you have an institution like the school, it tends to draw the people to the masjid. That's one of the things that contributed to the building of the community, because when the parents have to bring their children to the school, they're active in the community to a certain extent. So if there are lectures or whatever going on, they may stay and catch a lecture. The other thing that, as I look back in retrospect, that contributed to the bringing of people to the masjid was that we had a team, so to speak, of khatib. There was a different khatib every Friday. One Friday I was the khatib, next Friday Brother Nadir was the khatib, the next Friday Brother Hisham was the khatib, the next Friday Dr. Khalid was the khatib, and then rotating in and out, Brothers Jabril Zakai would come in. With this being the case, you had a diversity of input in the khutbah to Juma. It was not the anesthetizing type of khutbah. People would do research on different topics, and depending on the personality, say for instance, my personality is different from that of Dr. Hisham Hawasli. But even though both of them, our khutbahs would be based around certain subjects, it would have the particular flavor of that particular deliverer. So doing that, it would attract people from different methodologies, so to speak. There were people who would like to hear Dr. Hisham's khutbah to Juma. There were people who would like to hear Brother Nadir's khutbah to Juma. So, and I have people that come to me even today. Matter of fact, last Friday, there was one brother who came to me and told me that, you know, he still remembers some of the khutbah to Jumas that we gave 20 years ago, that they were not the anesthetizing type lecture. It was something that when you heard the khutbah to Juma, after the khutbah, you would leave and it would prompt some level of thinking to inspire you to say, wow, that's what he was talking about. You know, rather than you go through some rituals, you perform your obligation and you leave and life as usual.
So can you talk, now we'll get into, like, you want to talk about the new masjid, or you want to talk about this? Actually, let's stay in order. Mm-hmm. So after you had, you know, the masjid, the masjid, what was, I mean, where did the graveyard fit in with the school?
Okay. Yes, as we said a minute ago, Dr. Hisham and Sister Nabila came, and the school was started. Initially, it was the weekend school. Then we said, the weekend school is good, but it's not sufficient. It's time to take the school to the next level and to establish a full-time Islamic school, okay? So at that point, we started the building project for the Darnu school. And in doing that, not only did it attract more students, but it attracted more people to the masjid, because now here we have a masjid facility that can handle the traffic of a Yawmul Juma, okay? And now we're talking about building a school, the Dar Nur, which was twice as big as the masjid. So the school has two levels, okay? And once the school was built, then that brought more people in. And as time went on, the attendance in the Salatul Jummah started to increase, where we filled the top area of the masjid. We filled the bottom area of the masjid, and people were even praying outside. So what we did was we moved part of the congregation to the school in the basement, where the cafeteria is in the school. That whole bottom floor was pretty much vacant. So that was a musalla for the overflow of the Salatul Jummah.
Okay, and what about the graveyard? When did that come?
The graveyard came about 3 or 4 years after we built the masjid. We were faced with the situation again where people were beginning to die, okay? And alhamdulillah, Allah blessed us that there was a deal on the land that the cemetery is on. We looked at it. It wasn't something that we had to get rezoned, because that particular plot of land, if you look to the west side of that cemetery, you will see graves out there. So that cemetery that we're using, the part of the land that we bought, was a slave cemetery prior to Emancipation Proclamation. So the precedent had been already set in that area that it was a cemetery. And alhamdulillah, we were able to procure the land, and we were able to start the burying of Muslims in a Muslim cemetery without any problem.
So who was leading that effort?
Primarily Brother Tokir Wasi. It was near his home. He came to know of the land, and he brought it back to the board. We deliberated on it, and you know, as a matter of fact, it was probably less than 2 years after we built the masjid, because the first person to be buried in the cemetery was Brother Nuruddin, who was the chairman of the board at that time.
Sorry, I didn't get that. So who was the first one to be buried
there? Brother Nuruddin. Yeah, he was the first chairman of the board.
Can we maybe go back to the school for a second?
Mm-hmm.
I had heard that Brother Iman, and I think there was somebody else, and they approached Sister Nabila to be the principal of the school or something like that. Or
mm-hmm.
Do you know about this? Or
Yeah. She had an interest, a natural interest. As you have seen, she stuck with the project from the beginning. And she was involved in the weekend school. So we said it's time to take it to the next level. And we had tried other people in the principal position. And it's difficult to get people that have stick-to-itiveness, that will stay with a project for 10 or 20 years. Alhamdulillah, our sister Nabila has stayed with us diligently for the past 35 years, okay? And the amazing thing is she has done this fi sabilillah, you know, without a salary.
Okay. Can you tell me also, you know, about the school? I think Brother or Dr. Warsi was he maybe originally saying that it should be a school just teaching the Quran, or was it they wanted to have a full curriculum, Georgia curriculum, or was there any talk about that? Or?
I'm not knowledgeable of whether it was, you know, from the onset, when the school started, it always had a curriculum that was extrapolated from the Georgia school curriculum. We had always wanted to put emphasis on Islamic studies, because it would not serve any real purpose to have a Muslim school and not have a strong Islamic Arabic Quran program. So that was the whole motivating factor behind establishing the school.
All right, can we take a step back again? I was just think something in my mind. So, now, where were you guys originally praying before you had the masjid even? Was there like a house or where was that?
Well, there were different houses. There was one here on Ethel Street. There was a house over on 4th Street and West Peachtree. Then there was a building that we shared with some other Muslims on Simpson Street, okay? So those were, you know, but there was nothing really permanent. It was always a storefront or a house, you know, but the building of the Al-Farouq Masjid was the first from the ground building of a masjid in the city of Atlanta.
Maybe now we can talk about the new masjid where we are today, inshallah. Maybe can you tell me how like who started thinking about, yeah, we need a bigger masjid, and like how did this process start, inshallah?
Oh, okay. In the evolutionary process, as life evolves, the amount of food that it takes to sustain your body today is not the same as it took to sustain your body when you were 2 years old, okay? So the facility that we had at the beginning of the journey was sufficient for the people that we had at that particular time. And one of the amazing things about the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that He gives us what we need, not necessarily what we want. So at a particular point in our evolutionary process, the masjid that we had, it worked. But then we started to develop other programs such as the weekend school, and we had a trailer. And we outgrew that trailer, okay? So the next level on the evolutionary process is that we could either buy another trailer and put it beside that one, but then we started to think, we need to think in terms of a certain level of permanency. So when you think in terms of permanency, you build structures. And that was where the idea for the school came, okay? Once the school came, the program started to come out of the school, the community started to grow, the overflow in the Juma, the overflow in the Eid. Then the necessity came for a larger facility. And that is how this particular project that we are now sitting in came into existence. It was a planning that went on for maybe 10 years. Before it actually came into fruition. There were drawings, there were talks, there were things that were said, but it took approximately 10 years to pull the whole thing into the final stages as you see today.
Let me focus this because you're moving up.
Okay. Sorry. Oh, okay.
Yeah, wherever you want to sit, fine.
Okay.
Let me see.
No, I can sit back.
You sure you want to say right there?
Yeah.
Okay, so when we started the construction of the masjid, were there big donors, or where did the money come from, and how did this...
One of the principles that we always adapted from the beginning is that two things. We would first go to the community at large and ask for funds. The second thing is that if we did ever take funds from outside, it would be without strings, okay? There had been efforts from several large organizations in America to underwrite the project if we were to give them somewhat ownership of the facility, meaning that the property would basically be theirs in terms of title, and whatever programs that would come out of here would pretty much be dictated by their administration. We declined those offers, okay? With regard to contributions from outside of the country, again, if someone wanted to contribute to the project, we accept contributions, but those contributions must be made without any strings attached. So the bulk of much of the money came from Muslims within the city and within the country. There were some outside donations, but the bulk came from the masses in the city.
How long did it take to build this masjid from the start to, and when we, or maybe you can tell me how long did it take to demolish, and then after that, you know, how long did it take to build?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Again, it was a 10-year project. It was about a 10-year project because I remember initially there was the preparation, there was the getting the drawings, there was the surveying, getting all these things. But once we started to break ground, it was about 4 years from start to finish of the project.
Was there like a board or a group, a committee to decide what the masjid looks like, or who dictated all these, you know, the way, like the rooms and
Okay, there was a construction committee, and Dr. Khaled headed up the construction committee, and he worked in conjunction with several architects. There was one Muslim brother who was an architect who did the drawings. There was an engineer who worked. There was one brother who worked as a site manager through the whole project. He left his job at a company and came on board to manage this project from beginning to end. The company that did much of the work, one of our brothers had worked for him, for that company. And he negotiated a deal with them that it was almost at cost that they built this for us, alhamdulillah, you know. And, you know, so it was by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this project came into reality, because even though at the end of the day, I think it cost us $10.5 million, if we had paid for every service that was rendered, it could have doubled that number easily.
Yeah,
there were some chandeliers that were donated. They were a little elaborate, so one of them ended up in Masjid Omar, which is a branch of Al Farouk.
It's good thing you're reminding me about that. I forgot, because yeah, maybe we need to get into that also.
Right.
Inshallah.
Oh, yeah.
Do you want to talk more about, because I remember one time, you know, people were, you know, one brother maybe would take care of all the carpets, another one would take care of the doors.
Mm-hmm.
It was
mm-hmm.
this kind of fundraising.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to talk anything about that? Or
Yeah. I mean, at different times in our growing process, alhamdulillah, the community has always been very supportive, very giving, just like we have the family downstairs that sells the food every Friday. This family has been doing this consistently every Friday for over 20 years, okay? They don't make any money. They're not sucking money out of the community. They buy the food, they prepare the food, they bring the food, they sell the food and give the money to the masjid. This has been going on for over 20 years, okay? You have people who, if the masjid needed carpet, okay? Brother will say, well, I will handle the carpet, or if the masjid needed a water bill or whatever, paid, you would have people who would immediately jump in and say, I will cover that, okay? So much of what we have been able to do, or all of what we've been able to do, first of all, is by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but second of all, is by the selflessness of individuals that you would not even know. Brother will be giving on an ongoing basis, and you'll never know that he's giving.
Maybe we can talk a little bit about Masjid Omar, why that started and who started and all this stuff.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Masjid Omar, as we started the school, the community is growing. And with the growth of the community, many of the people found themselves living on the north side of town. Many people wanted to come to Salat on a regular basis, and to come from Norcross to Al Farouk was somewhat of a journey. So we got a good deal on a piece of land that Masjid Omar is on now, and we decided that we will put a masjid there. It started out with the trailer that's there. That was Masjid Omar, and it was primarily to accommodate our brothers who lived on the north side and who, for whatever reason, couldn't get to Al Farouk for Juma, or who couldn't get here for the five daily prayers. That was accessible to them. And as time went on, that facility even was outgrown. The trailer that's there that they have the Hifz of Quran in now, and the bigger masjid that you have at Masjid Omar was built. So all of this was in the span of a 35-year window, okay? We started with a bag, a shoebox, collecting funds, and by the mercy of Allah, we were able to build this facility and the Masjid Omar complex. Okay, Darul Uloom was a project that was the result of several things. One, the desire to produce Hufaz in the United States of America. It happened while I was the chairman of the board, with consultation with the board. One of the things that I felt was very necessary is that we create an environment where our children could learn without going through a culture shock. Say, for instance, if you take a child and you send him to Pakistan or India, he goes through a culture shock. He adapts and he gets acclimated into that culture. He stays there for 7 or 8 years. He learns the Quran, he learns the language. Then when you bring him back to America, he goes through another culture shock, okay? So we said, America is one of the most wealthy countries on the planet. We have access to land, we have access to resources. So why could we not bring a teacher here and teach the children Quran in an environment that they are accustomed to, and they never break ties with their family? Because I know with a family, for a kid to be away a year, 2 years, it's a strain, it's a stress, and especially on the other side of the ocean, okay? So with the shura of the board, we decided to bring the first Hafiz here to start to train the Hafiz of Quran. And that was Sheikh Abdul Ghaffar, who's now at the Islamic Institute in Lawrenceville. He was the first Hafiz that we brought here that was training the Hufaz, the first batch of Hafiz that we started to train here at the Al Farouk complex.
Can you tell us about the building that we have now for
Darul Uloom? Oh, okay. That building was a church initially. And we looked at it and we wanted to get it. And one of our brothers, alhamdulillah, may Allah bless him, made a contribution that enabled us to get that building, to use it as the Darul Uloom. As time went on, it needed renovations and, you know, repairs and what have you. Then we had another brother. See, Allah sends us what we need when we need it, okay? Allah sent us another brother who was able to do the complete renovation, or a group of brothers who were able to finance or underwrite the complete renovation, where you have the dormitories and the study area of Darul Uloom as we see it today. So everything has been step by step as Allah has decreed it.
Okay, Are there any other things that we haven't talked about that Al Futuq Masjid has started or owned or anything like that?
Not off the top of my head that I can think of. No.
Okay. Maybe can you talk a bit about the community who comes here, like the diversity?
Okay. Yes. Al Futuq is different from many of the other masajids. Many of the other masajids are either connected to a national or an international entity, organization, or what have you. Al Futuq has always maintained a certain autonomy. Decisions that are made here are made through the shura process in the board. We have always made Al Futuq welcome to anyone that's Muslim, okay? You don't have to be a member here. There's no membership. There's no club fee. There's no dues. You come, you pray, you contribute, you help, you build. So one of the things that I think that has contributed to this is the diversity of the founders of the organization. You know, you have African American, you have Pakistani, you have Indian, you have Syrian. There was Egyptians in the board, so there was a diversity of the community that existed in the board of Al Futuq.
I'm sorry, can we go back also to the community center that's being built? Like, what was the idea behind why we want to build this community center?
Oh, okay. The community center is another level of the evolutionary process. There is the second generation, so to speak. And one of the concerns that we have as elders in the community is that we don't have enough programs that attract our youth that they will naturally transition into positions of administration. They're not connected to the masjid. So the community center would be part of that mechanism that would further attract the youth, the next generation, to the Al Futuq complex. Because in reality, one of the reasons that we're making this documentary is to give people an idea of how Al Futuq came into existence, the evolutionary process of Al Futuq. But the most important thing is that the initial cadre that started this effort, of that there's only about five of us left. Okay, we're leaving one by one. So it's becoming more necessary that we give the narrative of how this effort started, because it didn't just happen. Two, let the youth know that they're in waiting and it's their responsibility to transition into this process as those of us begin to leave one by one.
That you want to share, maybe like any events or anything that you think you want to maybe tell us about, inshallah, or
nothing I can think of off the top of my head. No, because we pretty much hit all the hot spots.
Yeah. So again, when I'm talking, inshallah, you know, the things I'm learning from you help drive new questions, and you know, and when more people tell me more information,
right, you think, right. One of the things that I'm concerned about, and I've always been concerned about, is how we will transition the next generation, okay? My view, my dream, my aspiration is that your son, his generation, everything that governs this whole facility will be governed by a Muslim born in America. Meaning, when your son becomes an adult, every person in the board of trustees should be born in this country. Okay? At some point, my view is that no board member should not be born in this country. Okay? That's one. The imams in the community should be born in America, preferably raised in this community, in that they have a vested interest in the community. One of the things that breeds loyalty is when you have a vested interest. If you are working for IBM, you have one attitude. You go to work, you get a check, you get a vacation, you get a retirement pension, and you leave. But if you go to work for IBM and you're the owner of IBM, then you approach the work from a whole different perspective. And that is one of the things that we want to try to instill in the next generation, that they take ownership in this effort. They do not have to come and start at ground level as we started at ground level. Their next responsibility is to keep this facility running, but now the time will come where they will build institutions that will feed into the maintenance of this masjid, meaning the doctors will establish hospitals in this city, the engineers will establish engineering firms in this city, the businessmen will establish large enough businesses where they will be able to employ people in the city. So one of the things that I request from the youth is that they concentrate in their studies, that they excel in their studies, and that they become the people in the society that the American society looks to for guidance and direction.
Right.
Yeah. And also to add on to that, see, America in and of itself is a relatively new country. America has been around for, 250 years, okay, at most. Muslim presence, noticeable Muslim presence, is 100 years being liberal. 100 years in America. When we look at our position in this society, we have to look back through history and see where there are examples in history that we could look at and compare our situation to. And one of the places that comes to mind is the Muslim in southern Spain, in Andalusia and Seville. The Muslim in Andalusia and Seville were major contributors to the progression of the civilization in the European continent, okay? For 800 years, the Muslims were there in southern Spain. They were known as the Moors. And if we get an opportunity, we should investigate the Moors in Europe and what they contributed. Muslim have always been the major contributors in the math, in the medicine, in the arts, you know. And we as Muslim in this society and in this city more particularly have to take on that persona of the Muslim of Andalusia and be assets in the community rather than liabilities.
If you could do all of this again, mm-hmm. is there anything you would change about
We had this to do again. We would ask for more money and build a bigger facility and build more institutions. That's our desire. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the time that we have left, that He will enable us to build more institutions, because our job in this society is to give the people an alternative. We're not here to force anyone to become Muslim. We're not here to browbeat anyone, but we are here to be an example that anyone can look at and say, I want to be a part of that.
You know, all the lessons, Masha, you learn after all these years.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any lesson or anything you would want to maybe warn, like, the next generations about, you know, mm-hmm. anything about the masjid?
Okay.
Or with, you know?
Yeah. To the youth, I would say, the only way that you can practice your religion is you have to have a knowledge of your religion. And there should be a portion of their day, every day, that they sit aside to study their religion, to know their religion. It is time that we start to produce scholars from this society. I find it difficult that many of the problems that we face in this society, that a person in Deobandi can give a fatwa or an edit on how we should handle a problem here, wherein he has never set foot here. He knows nothing about the social fiber of the society. He knows nothing about the political mechanics of the society. He knows nothing about the economic inroads of the society. So it is very necessary that we start to produce a generation of scholars that are familiar with the society, that are familiar with the texts, the Quran and the Sunnah, and they can extrapolate and apply that knowledge to the situation in the most proper manner in this society.
I don't know if this is going to be maybe too broad, you know, out of the scope of this project, but I was thinking, should we give any kind of advice to just Muslims in general across the world, like the new like landscape we're all facing and things like that?
No. Talk about building your own house. Don't worry about somebody else's house.
Okay, inshallah.
Yeah.
It was 4 more minutes until Salah. Is there anything else you want to maybe say or talk about?
The point is that as one of the elders of the community, when I first became part of this effort, I was much younger, much slimmer, with black hair. Over the past 37 years, Allah has brought me to where I am today, where I'm basically a white beard old man. But when I look back at what Allah has allowed us to accomplish here in this society, I find that it's, in many cases, light years ahead of what other Muslims in other parts of the country have been able to do. And one of the things that I've found in working here in the Al-Farouq organization is that the mission is more important than the missionaries, meaning that those of us, particularly in the Board of Trustees, we will disagree, and we will disagree vehemently on an issue, but we have never allowed this disagreement to cause a schism in the ranks and divide the community. I've seen communities in the city and in the country that have split down the middle because of differences, okay? One of the things that we've always been able to do is that when the Jamaat decides to move in a direction, then we move with the Jamaat. Even though I disagree, I still move, and we let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be the final decider in the matter. So we tell the young Muslim, do not divide the community. You know, keep the community as a whole. There is no utopia in this life. There will be differences. Even among the companions of the prophets, there was differences. There was ikhtilaf. Even in the madhahab al-arba, there's ikhtilaf. There's ikhtilaf to the point where something is halal among the ahnaf and is haram among the shafi. But the two have never allowed this to separate them to the point where they will call one another kafir. And this is the problem with much of the Muslim world today. If you don't agree with me, then you're a kafir. And if you're a kafir, then your blood becomes lawful. So Allah tells us that we should bind together as one brotherhood and work for the betterment of Islam, work for the betterment of the society. Because in the end, the reality is that every one of us have to leave. I have stayed, and this is something that I have reconciled with myself. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me a very, very special rahmah, I have stayed longer than I will stay. So, it's time to hand the baton to the next generation, to prepare them to take this thing to the next level. Inshallah.
Jazakallah khair.
Hayyakum Allah.